Good afternoon. I'm Anita Farmer with the Washington County Chamber of Commerce, and thank you all for coming to our new knowledge today. We're happy to have Mikhail Haga with Virginia Hollins Community College. And she's going to be talking to us about constant contact. So thank you for coming, and we look forward to having you. Thank you.
And like Anita said, I'm from Virginia Hollins Community College, and I work out of two different departments up there. Part of my job up there, I am the webmaster for the college. I do the social media and some of the I do a little bit of marketing for some of the college, do photography, and just a lot of different odd jobs here and then. And then for the other part of my job, I work out of workforce development and continuing education, and do open enrollment and contract training, kind of like little kind of training. But also for that part of my job, I also help market the workforce programs, and part of that is by using constant contact and sending out our monthly emails. So we had adopted constant contact several years ago, and our goal is to send out at least two emails a month. Occasionally we get one email a month, sometimes we get four. It just kind of depends on what's going on. But we try to have a target of at least every other week to try to send something out. You'll probably see when we look at my emails, I think we're not hitting that target for the month because there's a lot of things that have been going on. So we adopted Constant Contact. There's some other programs that are out there that are free that I think the incubator, I think, uses a different, there's several different choices that you can go out there. But the goal today is just to show you a preview of Constant Contact, just kind of go over creating just a basic email newsletter, show you how to look at your contacts, and probably bring in some contacts, and then also how to just look at, real briefly, look at our reporting and see if who's opening our emails and are we being successful in sending out those emails. I gave you two handouts. If you didn't get them, I put them over by the check-in station over there. One of them is just an email design checklist that just got some good pointers there for sending out your email. Another one is 12 ideas for superhero subject lines. I didn't give myself a copy. And so it just kind of gives you, it's kind of just a cute little handout and kind of gives you some rules and examples of different subject lines you can give out, because one of the main things when sending out an email and getting it to open, one of the main things that you look at when you look at your inbox is that subject line, and that's going to be one of the first things that a user will look at. And you know, there's plenty of times I've just deleted emails, haven't even bothered to open them based off their subject line. And so we'll go ahead and look at Constant Contact. I went ahead and logged in, and the college has got an account set up, and it's got my name on it. But this is the college's business account. And right when we log in, we're looking at our campaigns list. So this is just a list of all the emails that we've sent out over the years. It keeps going back. And you can see right off the bat a thumbnail of a recent email. The title, this isn't the subject line, this is just the title of our email that we sent out. Our open rate, our click rate, and then you can see more. And we'll look at that a little bit more after we create our first one. And to go ahead and start with creating an email, it's real simple. You just click the Create button. And then you've got different choices here. We are primarily going to talk today about email, but there's other choices that you can use with Constant Contact. You've got email, you've got email automation. These are emails that if you have a mailing list or you want an email to automatically get sent out based off of somebody joining your list, then you send out an automatic welcome email. So the first email is more like a newsletter or something that we're going to manually create. Automation is just automatically going to get sent out. And they've also got events, coupons, and surveys, and these are probably topics for another class that you can and we don't use these very often, but you can send out events and coupons and surveys with Constant Contact. So I'm going to click on our email. And the templates are going to come up. And these are all the kind of general templates that have no pictures already pre-loaded in it, and as I scroll down, and so these templates are gonna be more, these are coming up seasonal with Memorial Day. Memorial Day, graduation, Father's Day. So these are all seasonal examples kind of coming up, but you can come up to the top and do a keyword search. So if we wanted to do, let's see, started typing in business, let's see. Just to give you an example, Small Business Saturday is coming up, it's just a quick example. So you can search by keyword, because there are tons of different examples as I scroll down through here.
Now this is the business version. I know there's a free version out there as well. So do you see all of this in the free version?
I'm not as familiar with the free version. I would say there's you're gonna have templates, but you're not gonna have as many. You'll probably be given, you know, a handful of free ones and then a whole bunch of business. So that'll charge extra to add on. I would guess that's probably how they do it. Try to get you to either upcharge and pay for a template, or try to get you to sign up for the full version. Has anybody used a free version of Constant Contact, Dan?
No, I don't think
anyone.
Okay. See, yeah, I use a similar product like MailChimp for anything.
Chamber uses MailChimp.
You get 2,000 customers or contacts that you could use on the free version.
Yeah.
But you can send as many emails as you want.
Right. Mm-hmm. I think Constant Contact is the opposite. We'll look at the pricing, but I believe
it's called MailChimp.
Yeah, MAIL.
Is there two different versions? Maybe one for nonprofit and then one for business?
Possibly. Let's see here. If I look at billing, I was thinking Constant Contact, it charges you per, let's see here, contacts, and not per email. Their billing's kind of, I'm just not hit upgrade. All right, so we get 501 to 2,500 contacts. So we're paying for the smaller plan. And I'm not sure if they still have a free version. I know that the MailChimp is free. I'm not sure if Constant Contact has a free plan or not. I'm only familiar with this basic plan that we've got. And so you can see the number of contacts, it can go on up to 30,000. And if I go up from 2,500 to 5,000, it increases about $20. So we're on the smallest plan that we can have there. And our mailing list is under 2,000 right now. So, and we'll look at that. And we've got some major cleanup to do with our mailing list. But you can see this plan, it includes our reporting, image storage. So you don't get charged under 1 gig. The number of users, we only have one user. So that's what the account's in my name. But we have somebody else that logs in for the billing purposes and things. They just use the one account. But the upgrade that has three people, more space. We do get to archive our newsletters, which lets us send out a link, kind of like a web page later on. It doesn't have the Facebook and Instagram photo integration, but it does have social media integration. So we do send out our emails via social media. And so we'll look at that when we post our first, or when we send out an email. I don't see any other plans here off. You may be thinking of MailChimp, maybe, or it may have been, they may have taken away the free versions. Okay. So I'm going to go back, click on campaigns again, and click on our create and our email. And just to give us some more examples of how to import pictures and look at the different areas, I'm going to do this general newsletter. And you can see the other example, this is blank. If you want to just start from scratch, you don't want to have to deal with arranging the text boxes and the lines. a basic letter. Sometimes you might just want to send out a letter via email, not necessarily a newsletter. And then a basic card or a flyer, kind of the, if you get the emails for the new knowledges, and they're pretty much set up to where it's an image in that email, so they don't have to worry about setting up the text and the pictures in constant contact. They set it up in their original software program and then bring in that picture. All right, so I'm going to do this first newsletter. And the first text box up in the upper left corner, oh, we've got a new editing experience. This might be a learning curve for me too. That's great. Alright, so the first text box in the upper left corner, this isn't your subject. This is just a title for your campaign or your email. So I'm just going to name this demo newsletter. And so in that first list where I was looking at all the campaigns, that's just a way for me to recognize. A lot of times I'll copy from month to month, so I don't have to put my logo back in there and all my emails. I'll copy it from month to month. And sometimes you might forget to change that name, and when you go back to do it again, you might have to search. So you want to make sure you name it something recognizable, so you don't have to click on each one and figure out what it is. Under your settings, you can set up upload your logo, so you don't have to worry about changing out that logo every time. So it'll remember your logo, and then down at in the footer, we'll look at these settings too. You set up your settings, your business name and address, and it puts it in the footer for you already. And we'll look at that just a minute. So your emails and your newsletters are set up with different pieces and parts that you can delete or edit. This top part, it's got our volume and our date and our month. I don't think we want to use this volume part, so I'm going to delete it. And so when I clicked on it, there's a little trash can. I just clicked delete and took it right out. And it adjusts the spacing for everything else. Your title here, just like working in Microsoft Word or any other document editor, you just edit your highlight your text to edit it. And same thing, just moving on down, you've got your text boxes. And if you were to log into Constant Contact and not have this editor, it would look pretty much the same. You'd have a little, the window would be bigger, and it would bring up this text in another window, and you'd edit the text. But here it's just letting us edit the text within the newsletter itself. So you've got your font type, size, color, your emphasis, bold, underline, your alignment, if you want to insert a hyperlink, if you want to insert anything else, a greeting tag, details, and then your trash can to delete it. So I'm going to leave that text box. And next item we have is a button. And you get your button, if this button wasn't here, I'm going to go ahead and delete it. If I wanted to put in a button from scratch, I go over to my left-hand side. These are kind of our building blocks or that we can put in. We've got image, text. I'm going to drag in a button. And you just drag and drop these pieces wherever you want it. So now I've got our button. And this is kind of where you put your call to action. If you want to order tickets, visit our website, contact us now. So your button is going to be your call to action here, and then you always want to give it a hyperlink. So visit our website. When you click on that, you've got this link button. With hyperlinks, you have choices of doing a web page, an email, or a document. So if you wanted to hyperlink to a PDF flyer, you'd use the document, unless it was a flyer that's already out on your website. So in this case, we'll go ahead and just link to our website. I'll just link to the college's website and say insert. So So now when you pull this email up, instead of it giving you the little cursor, you're going to get a little finger to click on that. Then the other areas that you've got that you can drag in, are your text box areas. So scroll down, there's a layouts heading here, and these are the different formats that you can put in these text areas. So right now we've got text and an image to the right. As you scroll down through here, you can see there's different setups, so you can have columns. And we'll just leave, for this first example, leave it how it is. And to edit this picture, this is just a placeholder for a picture. We're going to click on it and hit edit. With Constant Contact, you've got an image library where you can upload your own pictures. And as you scroll down through here, you can see I've got pictures where we were advertising our drone program, our training guide, computer classes. And so all these pictures are staying in here. And when I looked at our account details, we had 1 gig of storage. So all these images are counting against that space. If I was to run low, I'd want to come in here and delete some of these. But if I wanted to look for a new picture, not necessarily one that I had, I want to look at their stock images. I'm going to click on the stock image gallery. Now they charge you for their really good stock images. They're going to charge you. But if we wanted to find a free picture, say we want to look for a computer class, if I can spell. And there, some of these are very expensive. These are $8 a piece here. And a lot of these pictures you can find out, you can go to, there are several websites out there that have Creative Commons licenses, which means that you can download them for free and use them. These images are stock images, but you have to pay to use them. But they also have what I love is this free images button here. And so now you can see the pictures aren't as great. And a lot of times these are going to be pictures that you've seen a lot. you probably saw a couple emails where I used that picture. But they still have some choices there. So we'll pick out a picture. And then you're going to get a user agreement, and this agreement is basically saying they give you permission to use it, but only in Constant Contact. So technically you shouldn't print this out, and you can save your email as a PDF later on, and so you're technically not supposed to print that and kind of give it out as a flyer. You're only getting a license to use it on in your email. So I'm going to say yes, I agree. So once you get a little check, it's loaded into your images library. And so I said done. So now, once I said done, it's taken me back into my image library. So it's loading there with it. And then I can hit insert, and then it's dropped it right in there. And in the picture, it works just like with text. You could do the center line. It was right aligned when I first opened it up. Padding is spacing around the picture. It kind of adds a little bit of space so text doesn't get bumped up right against it. So you can turn that on and off and see if you like it with or without the padding. Then the text over on the left, you've got a header, a paragraph, and then a link. And this all works just like it did with the button. If you want to hyperlink text, you highlight the text that you want, and then hit the link button, and hit edit, because I've just got a dummy link in there. So that time I just went in and found a picture that I already had in the library. And the picture is the picture that I had, the second picture I picked was a little bit wider. It's not as, well, it's wider, it's not as tall as this one. If I wanted to crop this one, I went back into that picture, that text box area here, and come over to the picture sign, hit replace, and it goes back into my library. There's an edit button that you can use to crop your pictures. You can add features to it, enhance them, add different effects and borders, and crop the picture. So if I wanted to take some of that extra space away from the top of her head, kind of tighten that picture up, make it look more square. And it will, so if you're familiar with any photo editing software, the tools are about the same that you have in here. Your crop, you just draw the square around it and create the shape you want. Save. Sure, what's giving me the error, but again, you edit and you can do all these effects to it. Hit save and it's going to save on top of itself in the library, or you can choose to save a copy of it, and then you can insert the picture. I'm not sure why it's given an error. It may be that we might be out of space, may have filled up our 1 gig of space. So with it, once we get our pictures in there, our last line down here, since this is a new template I'm using, this name, company, phone, fax, email, website, all that needs to be edited or deleted. And since I've already got it down below, I think I'm just going to go ahead and delete that text area. And then I'm going to double check our stay connected is the links to our social media. And that's another area that should be set up in our settings. I'm going to go ahead and double check these links. When I double-clicked on it, it treats this as a building block, so it's opened up our social media block settings over here. And now we've got links to our Facebook, our Twitter, and Instagram. And since we don't have the Instagram in there, I'll go ahead and edit that. And you can also see you've got different options if you don't want circles, you want to have squares, different styles. You can change it to all one color, different colors for each one. And then hit that. So that's just real quickly how you edit the body of the newsletter here. We've also got our subject area at the top, and you just click on this to edit it. So we've got our from, reply, subject, and pre-header. The pre-header is supposed to show up before your subject area. Pre-header appears immediately after the subject line in most email clients. If you have something really exciting to put in there, you can put that there. Put it in there to entice them. We generally just try to stick with a good subject line. The from for business, you want to make sure it's a business name that they'll recognize. The from email, where we've got different email accounts set up for our users for the business, we've got a drop down here so we can select any one of the employees that are in here to be the from line. So in this case, we just keep this as our workforce email. The checkbox, use your from email as reply email. If I wanted to send something out, or maybe Melinda Leland, the dean of the department, wanted to send something out to 2,000 people, But she didn't necessarily want to get the replies from all those people. It just closed off. You put a different, you would uncheck that. So I wouldn't want to get all 2,000 replies of that email and maybe let that go to the workforce email. Oh, okay. I'm sorry, let me see what this is doing. I don't know what happened. I think every time I...
Updates.
Why? Let's see if I can turn it on. Let's see if I can force it to quit and come back on. I'm sorry. This is it. Well, the first time I talked down here, I brought my office computer, and it wanted to connect to all my software. It took like at least an hour for it to finally connect to everything over Wi-Fi. So I got one of our workforce computers that has nothing on it. I thought it'd connect quickly, and now it's trying to do a Windows update. I bet it's still on. So what I was saying, that got me off. So when you check that, you want to make sure you decide whether or not you want those replies to come to you or come to your business email. So if Melinda, the dean, was sending out an email, she may want to get 200,000 replies if all 2,000 people open it. But if not, then you want to go make sure it goes to a generic email for your business. And then your subject line, you want to make sure, of course, you got to give you the handouts to help you create a good subject line. You want to make sure you give it a good subject line that will get people to open your email.
I have a question.
Yeah.
And you may get to this in a little while, but once you set that email like that for your newsletter, we do a monthly newsletter. Is there any way to keep that particular template and reuse it over and over and over?
Yep.
And so that you don't have to always go in and make those changes, update that?
Yeah, there's two options. There is a templates tab where you can, right next to our create email, there was a template section.
Okay, I saw that, yes.
Yeah. So once you create that, you would just do a save it as a template. And then there's that option, and then I've also, like I said earlier, kind of opened up that same email and copied it each time. And
okay.
I've done that too before. But either way would work. A template would definitely make more sense for you for doing that. We'll keep talking a little bit, and hopefully this will restart.
And I can run down and get a laptop.
Do you have one?
Yeah,
that would
I'll
work.
Get one.
Does anybody have any questions while she's
got a real basic question. If you're looking to market a new product or service, how do you get your contact list?
How do you get your contact list?
Yeah, well, how do you...
That's the problem. There are spam laws where you can't just send out emails to, you know, thousands of people because it's a federal law, anti-spam law, went into effect a few years ago. So we have it in our registration. So we've asked for permission if we can send emails to people that sign up for our classes. And so if they say no, you have their email, but you shouldn't be sending an email to them. If you are a business trying to market a new product, there are ways, I know there's services out there where people can purchase emails. I'm not real familiar with any of those services. But it's just a matter of kind of collecting them from your clients or does anybody have any experience with your email list generating it? We've just over the years had to collect them.
I have a website and my website designer and Main Street host, they check, do I want to receive an email? If they check yes,
yeah,
we go.
Yeah.
And some people check no.
Yeah, so that's one option is to collect them online, kind of promote your newsletter on your website and ask for people if they want to receive your newsletter and join your database or your subscription list. We've had to, when we switched to Constant Contact, we had imported our list, I believe, from, I think we had just collected emails over the years, so I don't know if we actually have permission to send them. Well, it's already up to 7 years, but you never know if it's going to.
I made it.
Yeah, well, let's see if it really truly starts.
I didn't know what cardio meant. Well, what cardio, I've never hurt anybody.
It should give you a warning before it does that, just all of a sudden. Sometimes it does, it'll pop up and warn you that.
It caught you distracted.
Yeah.
And was behind whatever you're looking at. It's like a sneak attack.
Let's get into it one more sec, because it might be. Ah, there it goes.
Okay.
But let's keep this one in here, just in case.
Better run back up.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Okay,
thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. So yeah, the hardest part getting going with Constant Contact probably, or any email subscription, if you don't have an email list going, and you know that it will just have to grow over time. Then, once you get that list, keeping it maintained. The nice thing with Constant Contact in any of these is that when people click unsubscribe and don't want to be a part of your mailing list anymore, they have that option to unsubscribe. You don't have to maintain that. Just about every time we send out an email, we'll get at least one or two unsubscribers. And then our new subscribers just kind of word of mouth with our new classes. Make sure I'm connected to the right Wi-Fi too, because it, earlier it was really slow on my phone. All right, okay. And it did save, it does auto save your work, so it should have where we left off, and you can see a little thumbnail there of our email. Once I create my email, I usually send out a test, and I'll send it to 3 or 4 people in the department just to test it, proof it, test all my links, because usually there's a link that I'll get in there that's broken, or a link to a class that was last month and we've got a new URL for it. And you can put in up to 5 emails to do a test and then a personal note. And it should, hopefully if everything goes right, it should look just like it was set up in Constant Contact. Okay. Once you do send out your email, you've got some different rates that you can look at. You've got an open rate, 19%, a click rate, 10%, and then there's also a bounce rate that you can look at. So So, when I scroll down from my reports, I can see all the emails. The last one I sent out was May 2nd, and you can see I didn't send one out at all in April. And we sent out 1,116 emails, only 115 open. Our bounce rate, your bounce rate is our emails that are getting sent over and over to emails that may be wrong, like looking at our bounce list. We still have some emails in our list that are going to Virginia Intermont College. And so every month, the email system is still trying to send those emails to them. So this is just a huge list of cleanup that we need to do. Go in there, and some of these people may still be there, but a lot of them are going to be old emails that need to be cleaned up. Like this one is going to hotmail.com. It should be hotmail.com. So some of these would be quick and easy fixes. Like for Virginia and Vermont, we know we could delete most of those or all of those. Prime Choice Food. And then our mailing list for some of them got imported in with their name, and it just, the list is divided up by name, and then just by undeliverable at the top with no name. And we can see that out of this email we sent 1,116, had 115 opened it, 512 bounced, one person unsubscribed, and then 489 opened it. So you can look at these reports each month and see if your emails are doing very good. You can see that somebody needs to come in here and clean up all these emails, because this isn't a 46%. It isn't a good rate, but you can see with our open rate, it kind of gives you an average. So we got 115 open. Our average is 17, and our industry average is 16.7. So it kind of gives you a little idea of where you stand with your, with that email. Let's go ahead and go back. I'm going to go back to our campaign, because we created our email, but we sent a preview out, but we haven't actually sent that email out to anyone. And then we're talking about our subject. So again, you make sure you have a good subject. And then decide whether or not you want to have a pre-header, so I'm going to delete that pre-header. And then click continue. And then from here, this is where you're going to address your email. Again, you've got your title where you can change it. You've got your email list. All of your contacts are in these lists somewhere. And we've got different targeted lists sent created here. Ideally, you're going to send out emails. You could send out one to all 1,000 of your mailing list, or you can send out targeted lists. You might have 500 people that have signed up to learn more about new products, but you have 1,000 people in your list. You might want to target this email to the 500 people that are interested in new products. So our targeted list, years ago we had this administrative conference list. So anybody that had gone to any of our old conferences, we had in this list. So we had 64 people in there that we knew had showed interest in our conference, so we were going to send them that email list. And you can see we've got several different, we've got general interest. For the most part, just because we haven't been able to clean up our list in the last few months, we've been sending out our emails to everyone instead of just targeting them. But at the rule of thumb and textbooks, they tell you to try to target your emails as much as possible. So I'm going to go ahead and send this email to 5 unsuspecting people at my college on our workforce internal email. And then as we scroll down, we've got our from name. So it's giving you another opportunity to change those same things that we saw before. Our from address and replies to. So this is where I was saying we're running the computer cut off, that you can change who this is coming from or who the replies go to. And it should be set to whoever it's coming from. The physical address in the footer, this gives you a chance to change this. And you might ask, why do you need to put it? And it gives a little bit more information about that anti-spam law. So this is just telling us anti-spam law of the U.S. and Canada require you to include a physical email address in your emails, telling your recipients where you're located. It's one way just to show that it's a legitimate email. So there are some big, some laws out there, so I just leave things like that kind of set to default, you know, I don't mess with it, so. But it's, the program's really good if you don't understand something, it gives you a little learn more button. Over on the right-hand side, it says when to send, send now, schedule for later. Sometimes it will actually give you a suggested time. I don't see where it's doing it right now, but on some of my emails, it'll pop up and give you a little suggested time. Usually it's the next morning at like 6 o'clock in the morning. I usually, if I'm ready to go, I'll forget if I don't send it now. So I usually do send now. But you can see under send later, schedule the date and the time. Send me early results. This is going to be a little preview of that reporting statistics. I usually just send that to myself so I can see them. Resend to non-openers. I think that might be a new option. So probably it'll go out right now, and if 10 of you didn't open it, it's going to send it to you again. Let's see here. So resend this campaign to the recipients who have not opened it in 4 days, 3 days. And then it gives you a chance to change the subject line, reminder of the latest news is for you. So that's nice. Confirm. And it pops up and it's telling us that we're going to send it again. Okay. So that looks like all the different items we want to send there. So I'm going to say send now. And then it's just giving you another confirmation that it's going to send it right now. Usually they can do it right away, but it may take a few minutes. And then another reminder that it's going to resend it on Sunday and your subject line. So I'm going to say send. And then you get a little confirmation that it's been sent. It gives you a short URL for that email too. So if you find out a couple people that you work for aren't getting the email, you can copy this link. I'll open this in a new web browser so you can see. And it looks just like a little web page there. So it doesn't have to be in an email, in email format. You can just send the hyperlink to it. And then down below, we can see that it was sent. We can see our open rates. And then we're not going to do this part in class today, but you have the option to schedule social media posts from here. We'll go ahead and click it, but we won't schedule it. And it tries to automatically suggest several posts because it, you know, I think it will try to post once today, once Sunday, once Wednesday. So it's going to take that same email and try to post it several times on your social media. Usually I'm deleting. There's too many suggested posts on there for what I want, so I usually try to delete one or two. And I've got the college's Facebook, and then the workforce department also has a Facebook page. So I've got both of those set up in constant contact, so I can choose if it goes to the main college's Facebook or just the workforce. Then it gives you a chance to change the text, and what it does by default just puts the subject line in there for you. So you might want to, for Facebook posts, you may want to have more than just the subject line. And then, I don't know if it has any reasoning behind the pictures, but this is choosing from your picture library. You would think it would choose a picture from your email that you already have there. They're usually in here. Let's see if we can find them. They're usually a choice in here. But for some reason, it doesn't put it there. You think it would naturally just draw from the pictures you chose. And then it is telling you when it's going to post it. So it's going to post it today at 12:51 in a few minutes. You can ask for a new suggestion, change it manually to yourself, or remove the post. Then underneath that, again, it's giving you another suggested time on Sunday. And it's not doing the exact same post, it's gonna give you a chance to change it up a little bit, try to get more people to click on it, and again, you've got the same picture choices there. And then for the third one, so to remove it, you just click remove, remove. So here, if I wanted to schedule this one, I would hit schedule, and it would post it to both the colleges' Facebook accounts. You can also put Twitter and other social media accounts in there. You don't have to just do Facebook. And then the calendar, if you didn't like Sunday and Wednesday, you can come over here to the calendar and click the little plus marks and select whichever days you want posted. I'm going to cancel that so we don't post our demo on there. And then once people start opening this email, you get your click-through rates at the top. Down underneath your social media options here, you get another little report here in your click-through. When your contacts click on the link in your email, we'll show you the stats here. So you may have a dozen emails or a dozen URLs in your email. You're actually going to see which ones they're clicking on, not just that they open that email, but actually what they're clicking on within your email. So you might have your, like for us, we have our class schedule that we're sending out. We want to see if people are actually clicking on that class schedule. So at the top we have our emails, his activity, our send history, and then just some more actions you can do to the email: copy, edit, print, rename, and resend it. So once you hit send on this email, you're not done with it. You can still go in here and resend it, edit it. I've printed them before. The division sends it out to our distribution list, but then our campus, we've got a couple hundred people on our campus, and we can't put in, we have a distribution list for the whole campus, VH users, so it's sent to everybody, but we can't put that in constant contact because they haven't all agreed to it, so they have to be in there individually. So sometimes what we'll do, save the email, like print it to a PDF and save it, send it out as an attachment, or send that link that we saw earlier, so we can just have people open them that way. So that was real quickly our campaigns tab at the top. We looked at our reporting briefly, and then we also want to look at our contacts tab at the top. So this is where you have your address book of all your different contacts. So we've got over 1,000 contacts in here. And again, we know we've got a lot of cleanup we need to do on here. You can search your contacts. So if you want to maintain your users in here with their business name, you can keep all your contacts in here and search by business name or by first and last name. Right now we're looking at all of our active contacts. We've also got an unsubscribe list. So those people that are unsubscribing each time, see they're on here also. We had a whole bunch of people, employees that had retired that we didn't realize were in the system. So we went through and we had to manually unsubscribe them ourselves. And then our email lists are also over here. Now to add new contacts, we can click our little drop down here, add contacts, you can type one at a time, paste them in, or import them. We'll look at our type one. So it's just a general contact sheet. And then you'll notice that you've got a little check mark email list I have permission to send to. They're really making sure that you have permission to send to this person. So this gives you a little bit more information that yes, you have permission to send this email to the person, and it gives links to the anti-spam policy, so you know why they're asking that. You can put in as much information as you want, or just put in an email address. Once you have checked that you have permission to send to it, then you have an add to email list. So these are our lists that we're looking at. You might want to create a new list and start a new distributor list. Maybe we want to do a new knowledge list. We can click to create a new list, and we just give it a name. Create. And then it'll show up in your list, already checked off, and we say apply. The tags and the notes are just, tags are kind of like keywords that you can give these contacts. So if we didn't create a new knowledge list, maybe I'm adding all my new contacts from this class and I don't want to do a mailing list, but I want to give you the new knowledge keyword tag, so we can put it there. So that would just be another way for me to be able to search for you, but you wouldn't necessarily be in a list. And then you could add notes. This is if you wanted to keep this mailing list and kind of keep it as a journal, kind of I could make a note on how I met you and things to remember on the person. So just another area you can save info from about people on. So we're going to say save. For your import, I don't have an example of how to do that, but you would generally export your file from Outlook or Gmail. You'd export your contact list and then import it in. You can upload from a file, so if you're keeping your contact list in a spreadsheet, maybe an Excel file, you can import it in that way. Type or paste. This gives you a chance to do more than one, so you can just tab across, or you can paste them in. So this is kind of handy. If you get an email with 30 people on that email chain, you can just copy all those names off and put them in here. And just, again, make sure you've got permission to send them to them. So that's your contact list, your reports list. We already kind of looked at that. You can see here, this is an old report here, but you can see that it also gives you the report of how many people are opening your emails by mobile or by desktop computer or by your phone. I saw one report on Constant Contact's list website that said a huge percentage, like 40% of emails are open on phones. It may have been bigger than more than that, but you can see it just depends on your mailing list. Where a lot of our folks are probably in the office or college, they're probably sitting at their computers and not on their phones. And it's giving us a little spreadsheet or a little chart here, graph of all of our emails over the some time here, and kind of showing you a little chart of how well it opened, how well it did. And then down below again is our demo email. And still nobody. I was hoping maybe somebody would open it by now. I'm going to have to tell them we're going to get it again on Sunday too. And we had one person open it. And we're not. Let's see who opened it. That's neat. You can actually drill down and see. Well, Holly opened my email. And so you can actually drill down and see exactly who opened that email. All right. Let's see here. We don't have the forms option with our program. They do have a sign-up forms. And I believe it's kind of like with your events. It's a kind of another package deal that you can have with it. Your library is your image library. so you got all the different pictures that we've got. And you can see we've only, we're not using a fraction of our space there. So it's not, if your pictures are optimized for the web, I'd say you're probably fine. You're going to have plenty of space on here. Integrations is something a little bit more more advanced than I probably was prepared to talk to you about today, but it's probably integrating in with importing your contacts, integrating with Outlook, so your contacts are probably sent right over, and Facebook sign-up form. That is one option you have under settings. If you have a Facebook page, you can create a button on your Facebook page to automatically sign up for your mailing list. So on your Facebook page, you've got an example here. Here's just a little thumbnail of a Facebook page. And now at the bottom it says join my mailing list. And then it's a little mailing list form. And we've already got it set up on our page. You know, it's acting like it's not. Let's see here. Let's see what it does if I say get the app. It's taking us to Facebook. But if you walk through that, you can set it up to where it'll automatically get added to your Facebook page, and then people can just be on your Facebook page. You can direct people, you know, if somebody says, let me join your mailing list, just tell them to go to your Facebook page and hit sign up, so you don't have to send them a link or anything. Under my settings. under my settings, this is where you set up all the information that was in your footer on our website or on our email automatically. So we've got our organization name, our website, our phone number, and our logo. So you go to my settings and add all this information in so you don't have to upload your logo every time. And when I click on organize it, organization's information, it's just a little form field here, and then you upload your logo. Your signature information, if we're sending an email that looks like a letter, it's asking us what signature name we want. So we've got our name and our email and our logo. Under, again, my settings, email features, these are some more options that you can set. Your forward to a friend, add a link to any email allowing the receivers to forward this email to a friend. So you can have that set up. So that's another nice feature that will help you grow your database. And so you definitely want to have that turned on. And again, this is all under my settings, manage my settings, and email features. Okay. All right. So let me go back to campaigns and look again at our templates. We had a question about creating the template. I'm going to click create an email again. So before, we just created this first template there, but I'm going to click over to My Templates. And you can see I've got three different ones created here. I'm going to click on this first one just to show you how it looks from My Templates. And scrolling down, it just looks like the first email we created. Except for it's got my buttons already the right color blue, it's already got the non-credit course catalog. So next semester when we have a new schedule come out, I could come in and just update the text. Let's exit that. So to create your own template, you'd want to go in and find, you know, a template that you want to go ahead and edit there. Usually an option just to save it as a template. And then see that my drop down. It's usually an option right there to save it as a template. When they've rearranged the program, it's a little different, but if I had to do it right now, I would probably come in and just find that same email that I wanted to send out and do a copy. And then it's going to give you a chance just to, here we go, that's... I was telling me not to do that. That was just it was just telling me to try to use a fresh new template, not use your same old email. But so I just hit copy, and then it gives you a chance to rename it. It says copy of copy, so you just save this as template. And then update the info that you want to. There is an option to save it actually as a template, so it'd show up on that template card, but I don't know why it's not showing it to you. They do offer to create custom templates for you. They charge you about $80 to request a custom one. But it's really not hard to create your own. Any questions on creating the campaigns or the reporting, the library, uploading pictures or anything?
Do you like working with Constant Contact?
I do. We are actually getting ready to switch to a new software called Janoo, but it's similar to Constant Contact. I've enjoyed using Constant Contact. It's pretty easy to use. I think my hardest part is usually finding a picture that I want to put in there, either the size of it, shape of it, or if it's a stock photo you have to pay for. You'll find that perfect stock photo that costs $8, and then you're trying to find a free version of it out there. So that's usually what I'm doing. But the program we'll get ready to switch to is Janoo, and it ties to our online class registration. So all those people that are taking our classes are automatically put into our email list right now. You mark whether or not you want to be in our email list, then we have to pull that name out and put you in Constant Contact. Mm-hmm. So this way we'll have a whole lot more in there. And then we can target, you know, if half of you signed up to take an OSHA class, we'll already have all that targeted information in the system for us, and we'll know what classes you took. And so we're going to be able to export all of our Constant Contact information, our contacts, and put it into Janoo. And then we have to export all of our class users that have marked, yes, we can send it to them and put them into Janoo. So I'm not looking forward to getting a new system up and running after I've just learned Constant Contact, but it's very easy to use and user friendly, I think.
How many are you currently using Constant Contact? Are you using them? Using them?
MailChimp, free version.
Yeah, yeah.
I do MailChimp as well, and I will say that just to keep yourself from being embarrassed, sometimes it's good to see with someone else that maybe is on your team or a friend that can give them a second option, and to make sure your links that you're...
Yeah, that's what I forget every time.
Is to make sure that they're active, and I put links on the photos or anything that makes it easy for them to click that in the email that they can connect with you, that be your Facebook page, your registration page, your email, that they can automatically go to.
And one of the samples, let's see here, if we create a new email, I mentioned it, I think it's how the new knowledges are sent out, but I'm not sure. This one where it's just one big email, sometimes I try not to do that, so the text is actual scannable, like clickable, so you can highlight, copy and paste it, and click on it, so the different parts in it are clickable, the downfall of putting one big picture in there is that you can't, that text isn't clickable. The whole image might be, but certain pieces and parts of it aren't necessarily clickable. So I try to break up my email into different parts instead of putting in one big image.
And it's really good to check in on your cell phone, because probably 80 to 90% of the people you're sending it to, they're opening it on their cell phone.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
See how it works.
There's a huge percentage according to the Constant Contact that open on their cell phone. Our numbers again are low on that, but I think it's because a lot of people are open for the college sitting at the computer. But the cell phone use is definitely going up, and a lot of times they can look a lot different on your cell phone. There's responsive design, and there's different ways to design emails and websites for use on cell phones, so the pictures and things shrink and grow. And so some templates are made to do that better than others. So you want to check those and make sure that they're formatting on your phone the way you want them to. This doesn't have it. I'm not sure if MailChimp does, but some editors have a mobile editor, so you can switch and see how it looks. Yeah. So I'd still recommend checking on your phone, just because it may not be exact. But if you use MailChimp, there's probably, when you preview it, there's probably a button to flip it to mobile view, and it'll shrink down your screen to look like a phone.
Do you find certain times of the day is better than others, depending on your audience?
It always recommends for us to send them out at 6 in the morning, but we found, and looking at social media too, our open rates are usually later than we'd expect them, like after 3 usually. But Constant Contact recommends before 6. So that's another thing you can look with your reporting to see if there's a better time. With the bounce rate, when I was looking into how to get a better bounce rate, once you look past all those emails that are not deliverable, period, and then the ones that are just bouncing, you can look at if there's a better time to send out your email, better subject lines. There's a few different things that you can change and test from month to month to see if you'll get a better open rate.
I think they say the subject line is the most important part of your email, because that tells whether I get the leak or you've got my curiosity.
We just put newsletters so they know each time.
Yeah.
Don't delete us.
Yeah. And then you've also got, the little sheet I gave you that's got some ideas. And you're also competing with all the other newsletters that they're subscribing to that are also going by those same tips. So if you've got something that will stand out. And then the other handout was just an email design checklist. It kind of goes over all the pieces that we looked at on building the email, and gives you a little bit of pointers on each part. But once you get your template set up, you should be set with the majority of that. You just have to worry about the body on it. So.
Do you have any Do you have a best practice of how often you email? Do you feel like if you over email, you're going to get asked to be taken off?
We do every other week, or we try to do every 2 weeks, but you can see by my reports that we've not done that. And my supervisor, she wants us to email as much as possible every week, every other day, to make her happy. But I do think, even though everybody's agreed to receive our emails, I think you get to a point where you are turned into spam, and people may not want to open them up. So we try to, and it depends on the content too, I think. So we try to do at least twice a month. I would stay clear from doing it weekly unless you've got really good content that's really relevant to your mailing, to your subscription list.
So anybody
Have any thoughts on frequency? Are you sending out a lot? Are you?
No, we're sporadic. We usually send out a weekly newsletter, just for what's happening. We're a church, so we send out a Thursday, this is what's happening this weekend, and we haven't gotten our newsletter on there yet, but we're going to.
So that's something, I think that is more appropriate, to do more of a weekly thing for your audience. I think it would be more appropriate. And the chamber, you do?
We had been doing every week, but it was just too much, so most, right now what we're doing is upcoming events, and it's like every other week.
Yeah.
But we're wanting to come up with something to be more in-depth about the chamber and talk about the chamber board and different things. So it might be 3 times a month.
Yeah. And so I think for us, I think every week would be too much for our audience and our content. But certain examples, I think it's definitely appropriate. So, and then just watch your own subscription rate too. Yeah. I've tried to tell her every time we send one out, we're getting 2 unsubscribing and not getting any more subscribing. We need to do something different to get that to quit happening.
I think with MailChimp, after so many times, if it's sent out and it's not open, they clean it
off. Yeah. And I think Constant Contact does that too, but there's a lot on that list that should not be on there. Like Virginia Intermont should have been gone a long time ago. But it says in their help that they go ahead and take them off so you don't get put into a spam block. Because if you keep sending out too much, then you're automatically going
to
get.
Have you ever had someone to turn you in as spam?
No, we haven't.
We've just had maybe one person.
Yeah.
Of course, now we make sure.
Busted.
We just always make sure that we send out something that they sign saying that they want it, so we have backup material.
Yeah. And yeah, the law went into effect a couple of years ago. We just try to be good on it. If anybody, I've had people ask me to put new people into the system. Now all I can just do is ask and make sure that they've got permission to it. And then again, our registration form for new classes, we have it asked on that. Can we add you to our mailing list? And then adding it to your website would be a good way to do it. Any other questions? Yeah. Again, my name is Nicole Hague. I work at the college. If you ever run into any questions or anything, feel free to email me. I didn't include my contact information, but you can go to the college's website and find me. If you ever run into any problems or questions with your email, I'd be glad to try to answer questions.
Well, this is the last one for this session of slate of topics, and we're going to start next month. It'll be June the 6th. That'll start our first ones for 2018-19. So our first one's going to be Alex Scott, who is founder and CEO of Harmony Solutions. He's going to be coming. He's going to be talking about From Spreadsheets to Salesforce Workshop. That's his title and everything. It's going to be talking about Conquer Today's Complex World of Business with Salesforce. Everything you need all in one place. So we will have the information out pretty soon, I guess, and we'll be sending some information on that. So please make plans to be with us on that day. We're going to start doing them on the first and third Wednesday of each month. Everybody's got super busy and gone to different jobs and everything, so please let us know if we can help you in any way. We look forward to seeing you next time.
Does anybody not know what Salesforce is?
No.
It's a CSR, it's a customer sales, customer service relationship management. We use that at Virginia Community Capital to keep up with all of our contacts, anyone we come and involved in with our loan activity, everything. And it's just a way that, you know, people change jobs and so forth, but if someone leaves and they've been working on a project, you have all those notes and have them accessible instead of it being on somebody's one computer or what have you. It's just a great way, too, from a management standpoint, to find out how many active loans do we have, or, you know, things that are going on within the organization. So that is really growing. There's a lot of little things that you can do with Salesforce. So if it's something you maybe don't have now, you're thinking of the future, or you're thumping tires, it might be something that worth your time. Stop and get your McDonald's and come join us.
Well, on that one, they are also providing lunch.
Oh, that's right.
That'll
oh,
be a treat.
Please register. Let us know.
Yes. Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank you.